kind of headlines of things that I've done over the years, but I've been able to look at a lot of things from how much money is being spent on Black Friday and Cyber Monday to tracking the World Cup for the New York Times, and actually even did a report around Back to the Future Day. If you Google Joe Martin Adobe Index Back to the Future, you'll probably see the nice Forbes report around Back to the Future Day, which fits in nicely with the theme today. And I also, after a few years of kind of analyzing that Experience Cloud data, I got really into social and the possibilities with listening data. And so I was able to use social data to predict movie profitability. You can see the yellow line is movies that were predicted profitable and the mentions growth that they had. The blue line was ones that I predicted not profitable and how they basically didn't have any growth unless there was a trailer or announcement. So that was a pretty fun report to do. I was able to do 35 of 36. And that one I missed is kind of a sore subject. But I'll bring you guys into that later on in the conversation. So before I kind of go over what I want to review today, I want to take you guys on a quick timeline of where we're at in the digital marketing sphere. So does anyone know what this is? First commercial, nice, good job. Yeah, so it was in 1941, it was the first TV ad. It was a Bulova watch. It was during a Brooklyn Dodgers game, and it cost $9. So the 2017 Super Bowl ads cost $5.5 million. So you can see how much growth we've seen just in a few decades. Video killed the radio star for about seven decades until we got computers, which started the digital ad sphere. The Martin home got an Apple IIe. I don't know if anyone else had one of those out there. I got to love to play Jeopardy and Pitfall and other games on that. Apple now has $250 billion in cash, about a tenth of that related to dongle sales, and is the most valued company. 1983, I was born. No real global significance at all. Maybe led to an increase in Tweety Bird popularity. Zach Morris brought us the mobile phone. And my team showed in 2016 that mobile traffic surpassed that of desktop. So a lot of the conversations you heard earlier today talking about mobile, definitely key to success in marketing in the future. Of course, we all know how that guy in the middle never ran fast enough with America Online. But Americans now spend 10 hours a day with screen time related to work or casual. Anyone on the Friendster? MySpace, social's born. Social and mobile now account for more than 50% of digital ad spend in 2017. So definitely something that should be focused on. And as announced at IAB this year in May, digital ad spend overtook television for the first time ever. So we have this massive shift that's been happening over these decades from advertising going from these traditional sources to more digital. And I want to kind of take you in some ways that we're looking at social as a way to kind of capture that. And then lastly, in 2014, the word selfie became an official term in the dictionary. So today we're going to go over a couple of things. One, how social is the new panel. It's, traditionally people use surveys and other ways to understand their consumers. I'm going to show you how I think social can fit into providing a nice insight into consumer behavior and how it's interacting with your brand. Second, social data for all. I'm going to take you into ways that social can feed into most organizations within your company and within roles that you're working on. And then lastly, I'll kind of go over what I think is next. I'll jump in the DeLorean and go into the future and see what we can find. So this is a stat that we use quite a bit at Adobe. Gartner showed that by 2017, so this year obviously, 89% of marketers expect customer experience to be their primary differentiator. So that tells us that marketers have worked on the front end, they've worked on the back end, they feel like they understand mobile enough that they're trying to create these unique experiences, whether that's through advertising or whether that's through the purchase behavior of your customer. That's where marketers want to focus. So it brings up the question, do you really know your customer? Are you really doing things that help you understand how they're moving along the funnel, how they are going to eventually purchase something that you hope that they will purchase? So has customer research really improved at the speed of tech? I just showed you a whole bunch of examples of how digital has been expanding, and we have all these things with social. Has customer research really evolved with that? And as an example, I want to ask, first of all, show you a couple of things and ask you a quick question. So 92% of marketers say that social is important to their business, but only 41% are able to actually analyze social. That's based on, you know, tools or availability with resources that they're putting in other places. But social is really the new panel, it's the new survey. And if I could see each of you, I'd ask you a question. But I would say, you know, how many of you have taken a telephone survey? How many of you have done a survey online? I would bet that it's pretty slim in the audience. But if I asked each of you how many of you have engaged with a brand on Facebook, on Twitter, on any social network, either liking their page or engaging with their content, I would be willing to bet that the majority of the crowd would raise your hands. This J.D. Power graph shows it pretty well with consumer insights and how in-store observation, you know, we actually have CPG brands like Procter & Gamble will actually follow people around the store and kind of see how they're behaving in it. It's very completely unaided. Basically just have someone stalking you for a little while. Focus groups are very much aided, but also have a pretty low sampling. You'll maybe be able to get 5-10 people in a focus group. Survey has a high sampling, but I can tell you that most companies have PhD level psychologists or data scientists that are writing these surveys. So it is very aided. It's getting to a result that they hope to find. But if you look at social listening, it kind of fits in the upper right corner, where it's unaided, completely raw, and it does have a high sampling. So it really fits into kind of discovery research. And if you look at the amount of content on social, there's about 2 billion pieces of new content posted per day. And there's a breakdown there of the major networks. So there's a ton of content. What do you actually do with all that information? Well, thankfully you're here today, because I'm going to tell you. Social data for all. It's a true Oprah moment. I'm going to give social data to these guys. You get data. It's not a new car. It's not Dunkirk again. But it's pretty exciting. So data for everyone. And it really starts with the communications organization. Social is really consuming comms in that you have social media starting to get more legitimacy in amount of spend for advertising. People are worried about messaging and how that's fitting in. And also customer service. You know, if you look at a recent survey, 67% of consumers prefer using social media for customer service needs. Versus waiting on the phone or having to deal with automated voice that makes you have to repeat yourself and scream at the phone a few times. I'm really proud of that slide, guys. So. And I want to give you an example of just engaging with a consumer on social. So one night, I posted on my Twitter account that even though I was 33 at the time, but even though I'm an adult, I was indulging in some of my son's Nesquik late at night. And I had a few people engage with me, my good friend Brian Fanzo and some others. And within a few minutes, Nesquik was in the conversation. They were jumping in and they were saying, you know, we support your Nesquik Anonymous habit. And they followed me on Twitter. They actually sent me a direct message. And they said, hey, thanks for the great conversation tonight. We'd love to send you something to keep your habit going. And so they spent $5-$10 on this basket that's full of Nesquik coupons, this, you know, fun plush rabbit. And kind of the result of that is I've shared this example in multiple blog posts, tons of Twitter chats, podcasts, presentations, and that, you know, $5, $10 investment has led to, you know, hundreds, thousands of people seeing kind of how they've engaged with a fan on the, of their brand. So social also helps you develop customer profiles for more targeted marketing. So it's really going to help you understand who is your audience. You know, you may think it's 18 to 24-year-olds that are male, but maybe it ends up being you have a higher revenue point from people that are 35 to 55 and female. So it's going to help you create those campaigns that target those people directly and be fed by that data that you're getting from either social listening or social campaigns. And another example of listening is Target in Southwest. Hopefully no one was affected by the credit breach that Target had a few years ago, or the outages that Southwest had with their systems a few years ago. But I was able to hear both of the CMOs of these brands talk at a conference in March, and they both talked about how social was the forefront of their kind of PR efforts and the forefront of people complaining about being hacked by this this issue. So they used that for both reaching their customers, and they also used that information post-mortem to actually create solutions for to make sure it doesn't happen again, to improve security, improve products, improve where people were affected most and things, where their vulnerabilities were. So it fed a lot of their future development of solving these issues. So it's going to help you prevent or contain problems that can occur in the future. So what about thought leadership? I'm a huge fan. I've used data for most of my content pieces. Feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn or Twitter, and you know, I'll usually write a post every a couple of posts a month. And I really believe that unique data is the fuel that turns your content flame into a fire. I think if you can come up with some unique data point from your company, whether it be from social listening or any other data point, I think that is what really leads to content being truly effective. And this is an example of a piece that I did with social listening data. So public information that any Joe Schmo could look up this information and kind of create this content piece. And I found that through looking at some information, I found that Nike, Under Armour, and Adidas were paying about 24x for their sponsorships of college, in 24x in social currency, than they were for their professional sponsorships. So the hypothesis there was they wanted access to millennials and being able to get access to these athletes before they were professionals and some other things. But a unique, fun little data point that Huffington Post shared. And then I also did this ranking of college football's most social fan-followed teams. And for all of you BYU fans, I looked at Power 5 conferences and Notre Dame, if you... So BYU is excluded. And Michigan was number one, Oregon number two, and Oregon actually had their athletic department actually reached out to me, and we reviewed that insight a little bit deeper. So just kind of a fun little data point around sports with social that was all publicly available again, and kind of came up with some insights from it. And then lastly, nobody likes Nick Saban, which was not really surprising, because he's always angry. So we started with comms, and we move on to marketing. So marketing, the value there is product development. It's understanding your audience better. It's looking for influencers and how to engage with them. It's really going to make your audience from something very small to something that's much larger. And it's going to help you to find those people like the Nesquik example that can really be influential for your brand. We can all debate whether Kim Kardashian is influential or an advocate, but Airbnb did hire her, and she did 4 posts for them on Instagram. And the New York Times did analysis on that, and they found that it led to $400,000 in influencer revenue for them from 4 small posts. So definitely worth whatever investment they gave into her. So influencer marketing is exploding. It's much more than just celebrity endorsements like it used to be. You know, what is a new age influencer? If you look at some stats, like 8 out of 10 teens would say a YouTube star like Smosh is more influential than a celebrity, and that's why we get Ken Bone. So I was, true story, watching the debates with my wife, and I told her, I said, you just watch, this guy is going to be insanely popular tomorrow morning. And sure enough, he went from 6 followers on Twitter, 2 of which were his grandma because she didn't know how to sign up, to over 100,000. And he got a nice little iZod commercial out of it. So anybody can be an influencer. That's kind of the age we're in. We're full of, you know, social media stars that really are famous for being famous, don't really do too much beyond that. And that kind of brings me to the celebrity side. I want to ask you guys, you know, this is, again, really sore subject, so I'll need some comforting after maybe, but who is the guy who beat my movie prediction from the beginning? The Rock? Yeah, yep. Yep, The Rock beat me, he did. And it ended up being a pretty interesting story from it. If you look at the yellow line is his movie San Andreas, which is the one that tipped the scales against my prediction. The blue line is average, not profitable movies, about 100 movies in that sample on that blue line. And the purple line was Hercules, which was not profitable the year before and was starred in by The Rock. And you can see that nice low point in the yellow line is when I briefed CNBC about this report. And right when it started peaking is when I started biting my nails a lot because I knew they were going to ask me why I missed the following Monday. So thankfully it turned into a good story on how social can really activate a fan base and move things on. So we did comms, we looked into a little bit of marketing and influencers and how social can influence those things. Lastly is really brand and business. So at Adobe, we're using social as a primary research vehicle. We're trying to understand strategic decisions and how our brand is perceived in the US versus Europe versus Japan. One example of that was we wanted to understand how people felt about Creative Cloud and the move to subscription in the U.S. versus Europe and Japan. And in the U.S., we found that, you know, most people are complaining about kind of the price increases and things like that. But then we looked at Europe, and it was more concerns about privacy in Germany. And the U.K. was more concerns about security and their data being housed. So, you know, that helps us to know what we need to put into our messaging, how we need to improve our products, and how we can make sure that we're securing everybody's information and making sure that they feel comfortable with how things are going. And that really helps us to develop that strategy. So I took my kids to Disney World in March, and it brought up kind of a nice segue into this. But, you know, sometimes you're going to have those consumers like my son Cole here that was a little nervous when he met Mickey. He didn't really know what to think of him. You'll have my consumers like my son Knox that just give Mickey a full-on hug and loves every minute of it. And then you'll have some that are, you know, still happy, but then a little scared on the left. So social is going to help you know and help you find and identify those people and make sure you're giving them the right messaging so that you can turn those people that are little leery like Cole into the raging fans like Knox. It's also going to help you to know your competitors. So we use social a lot for competitive intelligence. It helps us to know kind of, you can get an insight into your competitors' content strategy with social and kind of see what content they're putting out, what titles they're using, what are people engaging with. All that information can definitely feed into your own strategy and help you come up with something that will have your own vent on it, your own brand on it, but could be an effective way to come up with those strategies every year. So we had the new panel. We had the Oprah moment. Lastly, what do I think is next for social? You know, it's been exploding for a long time. LinkedIn is owned by Microsoft. Snapchat is now public. Facebook is Facebook. Most of their revenue is from mobile now. My grandparents are on Facebook. Marco Polo is that beach ball looking one. I don't know if anyone's heard of that, but it's very much video engagement. So they're kind of jumping on the video bandwagon. Twitter is trying to figure out how to engage best with marketers and get ad dollars, and their investment in live video with Periscope. Which brings me to the Back to the Future segue, which tied in nicely with the theme today. So first of all, Facebook is working on something that would be a chipless way to post something with your mind, which is both awesome and terrifying at the same time. So you'd be able to post your awesome Cafe Rio lunch today without even having to pull your phone out. Next is contextual posting. So we've seen an interesting retraction in social in that there's been a little bit of social fatigue. There's so many networks out there that people are actually becoming a little bit more personal in some ways and using iMessage or, you know, Snapchat is obviously that way as well, or Facebook Messenger. So contextual means that you could post something and only the SLC SEM audience would see it. So it would be remote people around you that would see it, almost like an AirDrop on your phone. And then it would disappear. So that's being developed. AIs and personal assistants. Of course, Max Headroom is the best personal assistant ever. But Facebook M has come out. It's that nice chat bot, if you've ever used Messenger, that'll pop up suggestions when you type in things to it or when you send somebody a note. We obviously have Google Home and Alexa and how those things might fit into an automobile in the future. And then lastly, experience. You know, social is becoming, like I said before, the way to reach your customers most directly. And so it can be a great way to provide that experience. And lastly, if there's four words I have to leave with you guys today that I want everyone to kind of write down as a reminder of the presentations today, it's never doubt the rock. questions. All right. So, I know there's a lot on our blue jackets going on Slack right now, but let me pull it up here and get the questions. All right, so there was one question that I did have that I kind of wanted to ask a little bit, and that is the actual data that you're getting into. It seems that you're pulling a lot of social data for the long kind of cultural data and whatnot. But with the fatigue, or even like smaller brands, are there any kind of correlations that you can actually take to help drive that? Because I think what we learned, especially with earlier with Burke, is the experiences, and you talked about this at the very end, really kind of what separate a social experience and try to drive that ad fatigue.
Sure.
Could you take any other data to correlate like what experiences actually might hit the ball?
Yeah. So if you're a smaller brand, obviously Adobe, you know, we have 2 million mentions on social every month, so we have a large data set to work with. If you're a smaller brand, I think the competitive side works very well. You can look at kind of content strategies that other people are using. Obviously, looking at your own information and seeing what people are engaging with the most. I think you probably have to prioritize where you're getting your engagement. I think you definitely should be on all the channels, but if you're finding the most engagement on Facebook, then you know, spend your resources on Facebook or Twitter or vice versa. And then really just find out where your audience is and go from there. I do think that on the listening side, you may not follow your own brand, but you could also research, you know, IoT, Internet of Things, and artificial intelligence are very hot topics right now. Look and see, you can use social listening to find what are the subtopics within that that maybe your brand could put a piece out on. A content piece out on, or influencer marketing is very hot too. So even if it's just topical and not brand searching, I still think there's a lot of value in social listening.
All right, give it up for Mr. Joe Martin, please.
Thanks.
Thank you, Joe.